reason I started SpaceX was to get humanity to Mars.
We want to try to make the dream of space accessible to anyone, and ultimately making science fiction not fiction forever.
What they're about to do will change the game entirely. Four civilians are going to space. They will orbit the Earth for 3 days.
On their own.
You know, my dream of always wanting to go to space. I wanted to let you know that I got selected.
They start telling me about this all-civilian mission to space.
How many astronauts are going? And that's when she said, none. Haley was diagnosed with bone cancer.
I haven't died, and I'm not going to die.
Having cancer made me who I am.
My dream is to be a nurse.
I'm getting to show them what their life can look like after cancer. If I can do it, you can definitely do it.
I went upstairs after the phone call, though, and told my wife, I think I'm going to ride a rocket. And she just, what?
I don't think I'll think about the worldly impact this mission is going to have until Chris is back on the ground.
I'm like, why would they choose me?
Look at that.
But my dad had instilled this idea in me that I could do anything.
I'm commander of Inspiration 4. No matter what, I'm a father first, and that comes with a great deal of responsibility.
What is the speed?
You know, 25 times the speed of sound, or 17,500 miles an hour.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
It's getting real.
Our mission to space had to serve a bigger purpose, which is why it's a $200 million fundraising campaign for the St. Jude Children's Research Hospital.
There have been 3 black female American astronauts who have made it to space. I will be number 4.
I started thinking about what could happen and the risks that are involved.
These people are you and me, and they will kick the doors open to space for the rest of us.
This is where we're gonna live for 3 days.
Home sweet home.
What we see before us is SpaceX Crew Dragon Resilience, a state-of-the-art space capsule that will soon blast off into outer space right on this stream. Welcome everybody to Netflix live countdown to the Inspiration 4 space flight launch. I'm Soledad O'Brien here in New York City with somebody who's always lighting up the Netflix universe, queer eyes Karamo. Nice to see you.
Good to be here, Soledad. I'm actually super excited right now for that flattery, first of all. It made me feel really special. But the real stars of tonight are at the Kennedy Space Center, which is in Florida, preparing to rocket us into a new frontier of space travel, which I'm excited about.
Me too. If you're tuning in at home, it's probably because, like me and Karamo, you've been obsessively watching the new Netflix docuseries, Countdown, Inspiration 4, Mission to Space. It follows 4 regular people preparing to go where only professional astronauts have gone before, into orbit. So the first 4 episodes have all led up to this moment. After months and months of tireless training, the crew of Inspiration 4 is just 1 hour away from launch. I'm nervous and excited and nervous. We're counting down to what is truly a historic moment. And you can join the conversation. Use the hashtag #CountdownNetflix.
Now, as you know, it's already been a big year for private space travel. The outer atmosphere is basically the new Saint-Tropez, just with worse food. right? We're seeing all these billionaires go.
But. Yeah, exactly. This, though, isn't a joyride. It's a 3-day orbital mission that will accomplish real science, raise hundreds of millions of dollars, as they mentioned, for St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital, and, of course, inspire people all over the world. So what do we mean when we talk about real science? You might be shocked to hear that Karamo and I are not experts in real science.
Really?
No, not at all. But we know some people who are. Retired NASA astronaut, engineer, STEM explorer, Leland Melvin. Nice to see you.
Good to see both of you. And you know way more science and space than you really know.
Yeah. So Leland, you've obviously logged over 565 hours in space for our viewers at home. What is that?
It's like about binging Bridgerton 70 times. That's how I equate things now. This is why I can't go to space. You see when you start doing that.
Some people have done that.
Exactly. So it's about 72-hour trip. So what was that like? What can you get accomplished in space at that time?
In 72 hours, you can do experiments. But the biggest thing You have people like Haley, who had cancer, who was a patient at St. Jude's, who's going to go back and inspire all these kids to be astronauts, to be whatever they dream. And Jared Isaacman is going to be looking down on the planet as a commander, and they're going to be doing lessons with kids in from space. And so I think the big thing about this mission is hope, is belief, is inspiration. And in 3 days, you're going to have that coming down to the, all the humans on planet Earth.
I love that. We could all use a little bit of hope and inspiration now more than ever. All right, everyone, listen, we're about 1,000 miles away from Kennedy Space Center, which in outer space, that's nothing. But here on Earth, that's quite the drive, and I'm not driving there, which is why we're so glad to welcome a few co-hosts who are actually on site in Florida at the center of the action.
So joining us from the Kennedy Space Center is editor-at-large for Time and the author of Apollo 13 and Apollo 8, Jeff Kluger. Hi, Jeff.
Hey, thanks for having me.
And alongside him is a former NASA astronaut and Air Force colonel who has logged an astounding 6 whole months on the International Space Station. It's Katie Coleman. Katie, how are you?
Oh, it is launch day. I am excellent.
I like that.
I love her
launch
enthusiasm.
Day.
So the Inspiration 4 crew has had a very busy day of preparations. Katie, why don't we start with what's already been accomplished and what's still to come?
Well, Jeff and I were talking through it. I mean, it's kind of what we've all done. I mean, but the big thing is you wake up in the morning and you know that, like, this is the day that you are going to space. And there is nothing like that first eyes open moment. They woke up about 1 o'clock this afternoon. They had breakfast with their family. They did medical checks, you know, all sorts of things just to make sure you're really ready. And then
time to put spacesuits on. They walked out to the cars first in their spacesuits, getting ready for that long ride to the launch pad. And then there's that ride up the elevator to the crew level at the top of the rocket, and the walk down the gangway into the rocket itself.
And what struck me watching the video of it was just that it's just the four of them for so much of this. I mean, they walk out, they climb in these cars. We did this. I'm going to say the transportation has improved. Okay. We had the Astrovan. Right?
You had the Astrovan. These guys have Teslas.
One of the, I think, coolest things is seeing literally the four of them walking around the pad, looking up, you know, in those suits where you can really tell what they're looking at and what they're doing.
And that's one of the things about this crew. There's been a certain ingenuousness to them, a certain you and me about this crew. Mm-hmm. You know, we're always used to thinking of astronauts as rocket jocks and PhDs and test pilots.
Well, those are okay, too.
Those are okay, too. I'm sitting near one of them. But there's also a new breed of astronauts who are like you and me in some respects. They are you and me. And that's one of the things that's very appealing and very touching about this crew.
Well, and I think that's what's so important about this mission is that all of these people are different, as are all of us, right? And yet the spotlight is on them. They have trained for this mission. They are ready for this mission. And I really think that when they go, they take us with them. I feel like they take me with them.
They take me with them. There's 7.5 billion of us who don't get to go, and around 600 people in all of human history who have gotten to go to space.
Wow.
And these four are going to put their names on that exalted list today.
Well, I'm sure we'll get to it, but I'd love to hear more about all the time you spent with them as they've been training, because they just seem like fascinating people.
They are fascinating people.
Soledad?
Yeah, Katie, thank you. Yeah, can't wait for that. I mean, fascinating, but also regular people, right?
Regular.
Like, just great people who said yes to a challenge that I think some people might not have said yes to. It's
really one of those people. I wouldn't have said yes.
I would have said yes.
Yeah.
I would have definitely said yes. It's humbling to see how much work and time goes into preparing for a single space mission. I will never again complain about the long lines at the TSA. That's a lie. I will always complain about the long lines at the TSA because that's who I am. Yes, I would say yes.
But me personally, I don't think I'm cut out for space travel. First of all, I don't got the patience for it, and I also don't got the core strength. I'm just going to be honest with y'all right now. But we decided to ask a few of my friends from my Netflix family if they'd like to be up to the challenge to go to space, and I want you to check out what they said.
So would you go to space? it's space. It's something I've never seen before, so that'll be exciting.
Yeah, I think you said it. Just being able to see things that humans have never seen before right up close.
That's a pretty easy answer. Yes, absolutely. I'd love to go to space.
The whole journey to get to space is the thing that I would probably most look forward to. I always wanted to go since I was a kid because space. Right?
The concept of going to space is very intriguing to me. I can't even picture what the journey would be like. Out of this world, no pun intended.
I think if someone came up to me right now and said, hey, do you want to go to space? I would say, yeah, why not? I think it'd be cool to go up and then put on my helmet and then float around and look at Earth and the other planets.
Given the opportunity to go to space, I would 1001% take that opportunity.
I think it would be breathtaking to see it actually right in front of you. I'm frankly quite jealous of people that do get to go to space.
Luckily, I've been fortunate enough to go get lost in space, but hopefully I'll be able to go to space for real someday.
Well, I've seen Interstellar, and after watching that movie, I was like, I want to be an astronaut. But then I like worked out the logistics that, you know, my whole being afraid of heights, and I'm very much a homebody, so. No. But the idea of it sounds really fun.
Going to space would be an amazing experience, and I just feel like if I turned that down, I would be so dumb. So yes, I would definitely go to space.
Especially if they can reduce the travel time, because I get claustrophobic in elevators after like a minute.
I would say I'm inquisitive and adventurous in the visual, so just the thought of going to space makes me happy.
Yes, I would go to space, absolutely, because I just got my passport renewed.
I want to, like, jump up and not have gravity pull me down and, like, backwards flip 10 times in the air and, like, fly around by Mars and the moon.
Doing a bunch of flips in the air without having to worry about falling down would be really cool.
I'd have to think twice about this one, but yes. It would be fascinating. It would be an incredible journey.
Partly because of those videos with the astronauts where they drink water without gravity, I would want to try that 100%.
It would be absolutely genius to be able to go and see space, see that vastness.
Yes, because I love adventures, and that sounds like a fun adventure.
Space, to me, is something that encompasses curiosity, exploration, and excitement. And so absolutely, I want to go there.
Yeah, I've always had a fascination with space. There's so much that we don't know, and I want to find out more.
I think I could be swayed.
Seeing the planet from a distance must completely change your perspective on everything that happens on Earth.
Going to space sounds like a kind of intimidating thought when you first think of it, but it actually sounds like it would be a really, really cool experience. So I definitely consider going to space.
I'd love to see Earth from an orbital perspective, and as an aerospace engineer, I think it would be amazing to see some of the theory I work on go into practice.
It always sounded like the coolest thing ever. You get unlimited astronaut ice cream, and that feeling of the unknown would absolutely be the most exciting part.
I would 1001%, was that they say? 1001% yeah. Agree, I would totally do it. Welcome everybody, if you're just joining us, the countdown to the momentous launch of Inspiration 4 is underway. There's a lot of excitement, a lot of curiosity as well, so join the conversation, hashtag countdown Netflix. So Leland, you have orbited the Earth a few 100 times or so. I would love to toss some questions to you about this particular mission and other missions you've been on. You ready?
Yeah.
Okay, here we go. What is your favorite space fact that's not common knowledge? What would surprise people?
Venus, one of our nearest neighbors. Its day to night cycle is longer than its rotation around the sun. 245 Earth days to spin on its axis to have day and night, and then 223 days to go around the sun. So 1 year is 223 days, a day is 245 days. That's kind of crazy, isn't it?
How does that even work?
Doesn't make any sense. That's why he's
whatsoever.
The astronaut.
Okay, weirdest thing about space that people don't know.
When you go to sleep and you're falling off to sleep, you see these, you think you're seeing aliens, but they're these green flashes of light that pop into your eyes, but they're really not in your eyes, they're going to your brain. They're hitting your optical nerve and making you think that you're seeing flashes of light in your eyes. It's high energy particles hitting, boom, 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 and you're going, what is that?
Wow.
Kind of crazy.
Yeah. What is it like to look out the window of a spacecraft for the very first time? Take us back to the first time you did it.
Oh my God, Soledad, I undid my seatbelt, floated to the window, and I looked out over the Caribbean Ocean, and there were so many colors of blue that I needed new definitions of blue to describe azure, indigo, turquoise, robin's egg blue. What else we got? Navy blue, light navy blue.
Blue.
This color blue.
Dark blue.
Soledad, I heard this and I told him if he has a Tinder profile, this is what you need to put on it. Honestly, like I've seen the Caribbean from space.
Right.
I'm telling everybody is sliding in that DM.
Right.
Oh my gosh. Leland, I gotta just first of all say this. It is extraordinary to see you as a black man who is an astronaut. If I would have seen you as a little boy, there's a possibility that I might have wanted to go into space. No joke, because you're pretty extraordinary. So thank you for what you do.
It's not too late. Not too late.
It might be too late for me.
No,
listen,
no.
But we're excited about these four that are going into space right now. Listen, everyone, clearly a lot of you are curious about how you can get involved in space travel. And that's exactly the kind of interest and excitement this mission aims to inspire. So Jared Isaacman wants to, as he says, democratize space. That's why he chose three crew members who would never have the resources or opportunity to do this in their own life. And it may seem like we're a long way from making space flights accessible to the non-astronauts, non-billionaire public, but by empowering this team of civilians to break through that barrier, even just once, Inspiration 4 hopes to crack open the door of possibility. And if you've watched the show, you know as well as I do, it's a pretty special crew. Go ahead and meet them now.
I'm with the Inspiration 4 crew. Jared, Haley, Chris, the four of us are going to space together.
Every person who's going to join this mission has to be able to deliver a very inspiring story. We wanted a crew member to represent leadership, hope, generosity, and prosperity.
I was born on Guam because my dad was working at the NASA tracking station during the Apollo missions. My dad instilled this idea in me that I could do anything. Look at that! You're that close to this childhood dream. Whew, let's do this.
I told my wife, I'm gonna ride a rocket. And she just, what? I'm 41 years old, married, and got two beautiful daughters.
I don't think I'll think about the worldly impact this mission is going to have until Chris is back on the ground.
I never thought that I'd actually have a chance to go to space. This is an amazing dream coming true.
We wanted a crew member to represent hope. I can't think of anyone better than a cancer survivor who grew up to become a healthcare professional.
Having cancer made me who I am. I underwent intensive chemotherapy for almost a year. They removed the part of my bone that had the tumor on it. They were able to put in a prosthetic that could be expanded without the need for additional surgery.
I haven't died, and I'm not going to die.
I'll be the first person with a prosthetic body part to go to space. Such a beautiful part of life is you don't know what's around the corner. And that's why you have to hold on to hope.
I'm commander of Inspiration 4, first all-civilian mission to space. I started the business, we became Ship 4 when I was 16. Had a very successful day job running a company that's afforded me these opportunities. No matter what, I'm a father first. This is the first. First comes with a great deal of responsibility. It was very important to me to hopefully inspire a lot of people. Now, you have a chance to go to space.
It is so exciting to see. I'm so excited and a little nervous, I gotta be honest, but excited. Jason Ayer is a documentarian. He does a lot of work looking and talking and reporting about space. Jason, let's chat for a moment about how your day has been because you're in Florida watching this all unfold.
I am on the other side of the wall from the rest of the I-4 families right now. The last 24 hours have been really chaotic, really hectic, but very, very exciting.
Talk to me a little bit about some of that excitement. What have you seen? What are the things that have surprised you?
Well, we started out the day yesterday with the astronauts receiving a call from former First Lady Michelle Obama.
Wow.
We then went to a leadership meeting with Elon Musk to get a final go-ahead from SpaceX. We got the final go meeting just before midnight last night. We followed the astronauts on a midnight jog around Launch Pad 39A. Soon after that, we had cameras with the astronauts until after 3 a.m. last night. We woke up today. We had final flight rehearsals in Jared Isaacman's room. final medical tests. We had a send-off luncheon with close family, and now we're all here a mile away from the launch pad with these families as they watch their loved ones make history.
Wow, this is pretty amazing. You know, you talk about the family members and the loved ones. I want to know, what type of anxiety are these individuals who are about to become the first civilians ever to go into space feeling, and how are they supporting each other and getting through those anxious moments?
I think there's a natural anxiety, of course, because you're launching a rocket into space, whether you're a professional astronaut or a civilian astronaut who's new to this. But the leadership and the support staff around SpaceX, the trainers who are preparing them for this, and the team that they have escorting these astronauts through it, has really imbued this entire process with a sense of safety and security and confidence. Mm. So I think that everybody, it's more excitement, I would say, than anxiety right now. Mm. Everyone is obviously on pins and needles because their loved ones are sitting in that capsule as we speak, but everyone is raring to go to watch this thing go up.
It is so exciting. Even just looking at some of these pictures as we get ready for this launch, it's really, really amazing. Jason Ayer is the director, of course, and a lot of what we've been looking at today is the work that he's been doing. Has anything surprised you? I mean, clearly you've been in the middle of this story for a long time now, and yet this is the moment everybody's been waiting for.
I think it's been cool. We've observed, you know, these four strangers coming together since January. I wouldn't say it's surprising, but it's really heartening to me to see how close they have become in such a short period of time. These are going to be lifelong friends, and these families are really now one big family. So to see them interacting with each other, the moments that we were lucky enough to capture last night, there was a family tour of the launch pad, and all the families went up there with the astronauts, and they saw the Falcon 9 upright. They saw the capsule on top of that Falcon. So seeing them become this one big family when they were four separate families has been one of the most rewarding parts of this project.
Yeah, that's amazing. Jason Ayer is the director. Amazing. Thank you for that. Let's check in with Jeff, because, of course, Jason's been talking sort of about this family atmosphere. And, Jeff, I'm curious, what's special about this crew? I mean, could you have just picked sort of four random people and sort of be having the same experience?
Well, the whole idea of this mission was that in theory we could pick four random people, but through the luck of the draw and through just great good serendipitous fortune, they picked four extraordinary people. Cyan Proctor is a professor of geosciences at South Mountain Community College. She's also an artist. She's an eclectic person. Chris Zembrowski is a father of two, deeply devoted family man, a data engineer with Lockheed Martin. Helly Arsenault, of course, is a childhood cancer survivor. So all of these folks have brought particular life experiences, particular life views to the work that they've done. And they have been able to train, and Katie could speak to this also, they've been able to train in 8 months the kind of training that takes typical astronaut crews about 2 years to master. So they've moved quickly, they've moved adeptly, they've moved adroitly, and they've moved successfully. Mm. And Soledad?
Yeah, I mean, and you know, you say 2 years squished into 8 months, which again triggers a little stress.
A little trigger, right?
I gotta be honest with you.
Soledad, can we just mention really quickly, because the anxiety and the stress that I'm feeling for them, we are about 39 minutes until this is happening.
Yeah, absolutely. Things are heating up at the Kennedy Space Center in Florida, where we inch closer and closer to the launch of Inspiration 4's 3-day journey into space. It's the culmination, as Jeff just mentioned, months of hard work for that team at SpaceX, the crew. We have some really great footage of the preparations from the Netflix docuseries Countdown Inspiration 4, Mission to Space. So, Leland, I want you to talk us through some of these training exercises that we're looking at here. That looks like a centrifuge.
Yeah, so that's exactly. You've been in one before, right?
Yeah, no, because I declined the opportunity.
So that's a NASTAR centrifuge, which is accelerating the number of Gs on your body. So right now we're standing on Earth, we're 1 G, some 200 pounds. But in that accelerator, you're feeling 3.5 to 4.5 times a G. So that's 4 times your weight. here on the ground that you would actually feel. And one of the things that we do for that training is we make sure that your body can handle the mission profile that the rocket's going through. So you're going through different profiles of G's on your body. When you come home, you get different G's on your body. So making sure that you can do that when you're going through this training. And that's one of the most important things. But the other thing is, you have this whole group of people that are helping you get ready for this mission. They're doing things that are pushing their bodies. They hiked up at the top of Mount Rainier in snow, and Haley has a prosthetic leg. So everyone's helping each other. That's the beautiful thing about a team. Jared is such a great leader that he put people in situations to test them, to push them a little bit further so that when things get tough in space, you're ready for it.
Did you do the same thing as an astronaut for NASA when you were also doing team building in addition to a lot of the training exercises?
Yeah, we went on a Knowles trip. We hiked in the Utah mountains with 80-pound backpacks, and our goal was to go for 10 days and support each other, find water, live, eat. But, you know, things get hard there, things get hard in space. And I think one of the things that Jared is really trying to do is to show that, you know, no matter where you're coming from, no matter what skill levels you have, you can come together with the right training and be a successful team functioning at a high level. And that's a really high level because they're going up higher than the Hubble Space Telescope, higher than the space station, higher than, you know, 224 miles, 360 miles. They're going to get 360 miles up. And that's highest than any civilians or other
astronauts. It's actually a great message just to pass on, period, that we all have the resiliency inside of us to overcome any challenge that's in front of us. And to see these civilians doing this in space kind of just gives you that feeling right here on, like, whatever you're going through right now on Earth, you can get through it. You can deal with it.
Pandemic, I don't know that I'd make it up Mount Rainier, to be honest. And certainly not with a prosthetic leg.
But if you have the right support, right?
Yeah.
Access, opportunity, and belief in yourself can take you to great places.
Y'all didn't know Leland was going to take us to church today, right? Did y'all? Right. Y'all didn't know that. All right.
How long were you able to stay in the centrifuge?
I was in there for the entire, you know, time, which was less than Katie Coleman.
Right? Apparently, first of all, Katie Coleman is like this big and weighs 98 pounds soaking wet. And you hold the record, right, Katie, for staying in the centrifuge?
Thanks, Katie.
Which, by the way, looks terrible.
I know.
All those records are different, you know, but I did do like 18 minutes and the guys did about 6.
Huh, interesting.
Which was pretty fun.
Come on.
She gets her props. You get your props.
I think for, you know, just knowing that, I was going to say, you know, you don't wake up, you know, you're not born thinking, oh, I can do that. But it's something that, you know, the environment around you, I think that this mission, these people doing these things, they've done things that they never thought they could do, but they always had it in them. And the whole, the greater purpose is for people who are watching to realize they have stuff inside them too, and we all need it. We need it to save the planet.
Listen, I've spent a lot of time with Katie, and she literally has a laptop, and if you give her 3 minutes, she will show you all the pictures of her time in space because it's so inspiring to see your point of view. It's really quite amazing.
Katie, can we just say really quickly how amazing you are? I think it's just important just to point that out, like, really. Give you your flowers while you are here with us, right?
I want to be like Katie when I grow up.
Yes.
I tell her that.
Well, you know,
all the
growing up part is the part of the question there, Leland, right?
That's a good point. Yeah. Mm-hmm.
But what do you mean? There's a question?
Well, not that we are grown up down here.
Oh.
No.
Actually, you know, whether he's going to grow up or is a grown up. But actually, there is something I think, you know, I'm looking at Jeff, that's kind of childlike about all of us, really. And it's because there's that sort of compelling, wondrous part of going to space, a thing that you thought no one real got to do. And suddenly you got to do that.
Well, that's exactly right. I often say that the very first memory to which I can affix a date was Sputnik in 1957. Mm-hmm. I remember being a 3-year-old boy and watching Sputnik go over Northwest Baltimore. I was hooked at that age. I have never lost that space ingenuousness that I had back in 1957. It was with me then. It remains with me now. I don't think you can lose it. It's an emotional, spiritual, thrilling virus that stays with you forever.
Yeah.
Even just driving in here today, there's something magical about the Space Center here where, you know, the vehicle assembly building just gets bigger and bigger and bigger, and you're trying not to, like, give it a temptation and take a video of it just approaching. But there's magic happens at this place, Katie, and there's special people that make it happen.
Katie, the interesting part is that we can feel that magic even here in New York, and I'm sure everyone watching around the world can feel that same magic. We're 34 minutes until this launch happens, but I want to ask you a question, Leenlet, because right now we're seeing this rise of private space flights, and I want to know, for you as a professional astronaut, what does that mean for you and your job and your career?
So my colleagues, Katie and Ron, and all the other professional astronauts, embrace our new brothers and sisters. Mm. Because the more people that have this chance to go off the planet and get this change in the way you see humanity, you go around the planet every 90 minutes, you see a sunrise and a sunset every 45, and you're looking at no political borders. Mm. It's peace, it's love. And so if more people can do that, we embrace everyone to make this place better.
Did you ever think there would one day be like civilians who'd be up in space?
Even think Leland Melvin would be in space, so I was kind of like you, bro.
Yeah.
But once it happened, then I realized that it's possible for anyone. If I can go, a skinny black kid from Lynchburg, Virginia can go to space, anyone can go to space. And I think the more people, like I said, that get the opportunity, it changes us. It makes us come together as one family.
Yeah.
When we're in space, I'm with Russians, Germans, French, African-American, Asian-American, the first female commander. If we don't work together, we perish.
Listen.
And let's bring that message down here to New York City, right?
Teamwork, unity, the things that we're leading and that we're learning right now from the Inspiration4. This is amazing. So listen, so much of the future of space exploration seems to hinge on the difference between space missions and space tourism. To talk more about that important distinction, we welcome back our friends at the Kennedy Space Center, who are joined now by a very special guest, former NASA astronaut and fighter pilot and the author of Floating in Darkness. His name is Ron Guerin. Ron, I heard that you and Katie have logged some minutes in zero G together. Is that true?
Yeah, we logged some minutes. We also logged some months.
It's true.
we had a really exciting mission together on board the International Space Station. But we're at a really exciting time right now. We've had an exciting summer for commercial spaceflight. We're about to culminate the summer with really one of the most historic things I can think of right now, which is a commercial orbital flight. And, you know, I think that's a really important distinction between what we saw with Virgin Galactic or with Richard Branson, and then a week later, a little bit over a week later, with Jeff Bezos on Blue Origin. Those are suborbital flights, and they were spectacular. But you have to understand that this is an order of magnitude more difficult, more challenging, more risky, what we're gonna experience here in just a little bit. And they're going from 0 miles per hour sitting on the pad to 17,500 miles per hour. That's 5 miles a second. And as Leland said before, they're going to orbit the Earth every 90 minutes, see a sunrise or a sunset every 45 minutes. They're not just going for a few minutes of weightlessness. They're going for a few days. And this is a crew that has trained together for months. And each of them, there's no passengers on this flight. They're all crew members with unique roles. And it's a real mission that they're about to embark on. It's really, really exciting.
Hey, Ron,
no question. And even...
Go ahead, Katie. I'm sorry for interrupting you.
I was just going to say, you were saying, 3 days. And some people might think that that's really short.
Yeah.
I mean, it is short. I mean, actually, it'd be nice to go for months. I really loved it being up there, even with you. You know, but even a few seconds, even like 30 seconds is enough time here on Earth of being able to do an experiment and learn something about how something behaves. And then getting to go for, a few minutes is even more data. You know, in the 3 or 4 minutes, we talk about the flights that are sort of, we call them tourist flights, but they're collecting a lot of experimental data in just those 3 or 4 minutes. And so in 3 days, I cannot wait to see what this crew comes up with.
You know, Ron, I was going to ask you, talk to me a little bit about the value of that tourism, because it does seem like short and maybe suborbital. Is there value to the space tourists?
Yeah, I think there is. I think the more people, and we've heard this over and over again, the more people that have the opportunity to see the planet from that vantage point, the better off we're all going to be. I don't think we know anybody that has come back to space and wasn't more inspired to protect the planet, to take care of the planet, to take care of each other. I think it's a really unifying, remarkable experience to see the planet from that vantage point.
And even for a few minutes. I mean, I think that I see, each of these people who have been, creating a road to space, a path to space, it's their way of bringing people along. A few minutes and looking down, seeing the Earth and you know, having that perspective, when you get home, you realize there is a lot to do down here, and you need to use your means and resources to do that.
Yeah.
So they're all special missions, every one of
they're
them.
They're all special missions.
Soledad? Yeah.
I love it. I love it. Thank you, Katie. Thank you, Ron. And I'm sure these conversations are going to continue for years to come, right? If you think there's a value in just a couple of minutes, I mean, that's just amazing what we're getting to see today. The allure of space travel certainly is not going away.
Yeah. Now, Leland, you have a few space travel underneath your belt. So what was one of those missions like for you? What was your role?
My role as a mission specialist was to help us get to space safely. And then I had to install this $2 billion laboratory, the European Space Agency's laboratory. And it was with a robotic arm. And once it was installed, all of those people had job security. If I had messed up, 10,000 people in Europe would have been without a job.
Woo!
And then after that, we broke bread, we celebrated, and then we did some more work. And then my second mission was to install spare parts on the space station with the first time two African-American men were in space at the same time. And so representation mattered. We talked to kids, we talked to everyone, and kids came up to us after and said, I'm gonna be an astronaut too, Mr. Melvin.
Yeah.
Right? So that was amazing.
Like I said, if I would have saw you as a kid, I might have been an astronaut. But right now, I feel like my role on the flight would have probably been like vibe specialist. I would have got like, everybody feeling like, good,
yeah,
checking in with their emotions, doing a little bit of a TikTok dance.
Yeah, that's
is that
not
actually a
thing.
Job?
No, that's
not a thing? No. Okay. Well, we actually asked some of my Netflix family what roles they'd play on a spaceship, and I want you to see what they had to say because it's kind of hilarious.
I just got my driver's license, and I definitely would want to be the pilot of the spaceship.
I think I would be the emotional support. I feel like that's a very underrated crew member. You need a support system. You need a cheerleader, and that's when I come in.
If I had a job on a spaceship, it'd probably be something in logistics. Not like the leader, but definitely figuring out what the game plan is.
Biochemistry. Well, I dabble in astrophysics, but those are my two things. What? I wasn't always an actor.
I'm an aerospace engineer, so maybe I could help fix things. And also, I'm a baker, too. So maybe some zero-G baking, maybe some cookie dough up there. People get a bit peckish.
You gotta laugh when you're in space.
You need someone to keep you entertained.
Comedic relief.
You know I'd be working those computers.
Yeah, babe, you'll be building robots.
Probably being the organized one, I think it'd be cool for me to keep a journal so I could read it when I'm back home on Earth.
To catch everything that's floating around and to probably clean the rocket.
The first space air hostess.
I can pour mate really well. Mate is an Argentinian tea. And I do a really, really good job at it. And I think that keeps the morale and keeps everybody nice and warm.
I'm a good cook. I don't know how I would cook if like my barbecue grill was moving or the smoker's moving. Well, I couldn't really have a smoker, could we? I wonder where smoke goes in space. Anybody know? Can you make ribs in space?
If I was on a space crew, my job would definitely be the engineer. I've been programming since I was 13. I love being able to build things with code, and so I think I'll be able to fix things that break.
I think literally the only skill I have right now is being short or small, and you need all the space you can get, right?
I'm a really good packer. I mean, like, I'm serious. Like, if they need someone to pack in the tight quarters and get as much as they can possibly squeeze in there, I'm your girl.
I feel like my job would be the captain because I need to be in control to make sure everyone does their job correctly and stays on top of everything.
I would be the flight engineer, assisting the pilot, doing tasks, all the other stuff. I think that's what I would be.
I think my job would be the assistant to the captain because I'm hardworking. I just don't give up, and I just bring a positive spirit and a great mindset.
I think I would potentially be the pilot. I have my resume lying here. I will be faxing it to NASA. Space Commander, let's do this.
Being the lookout and making sure that nothing goes wrong. I would be very alert and probably the first person to call out anything even slightly unusual, like what is that thing floating towards us?
I definitely think my job would be the software engineer or programmer of the space crew.
If anyone needs nightly entertainment, I love to play the guitar and sing.
I will be the beatboxer for our space rap battles because, I mean, you have to do those when going to space.
I think the skill that I would bring to the ship would be comedic relief, because my dad jokes right now are pretty good, but if you put me on a spaceship, they'll be out of this world.
I'm joined now by another special guest. He's not an astronaut, but his work is just as inspiring. The CEO of ALSAC, the fundraising and awareness organization for St. Jude's Children's Research Hospital, Rick Shadyac. Nice to see you, Rick. Thank you for talking with me.
Thank you for having me, Soledad. It's good to see you.
Thank you. Likewise, Inspiration4, of course, isn't just about space exploration. It's about raising critical funds for the life-saving work of the St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. Explain to us exactly how St. Jude's benefits from this mission.
We owe it all to Jared Isaacman, the commander of Inspiration4, an incredible philanthropist and family man who decided once he was going to go to space, he wanted to make this mission have a purpose. And I know he thought about other charities, but he decided on St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. He knows that we've always been about stretching boundaries and doing what seems impossible and making it become a reality. We saw the similarities between the missions, and this incredible man, Soledad, made a $100 million commitment and said, hey, Rick, let's try to raise $200 million to find cures and save children's lives.
Amazing. So the fundraising goal is $200 million. How are you trying to get all of us, everybody who's watching, doesn't get to go up into space, but gets to participate today and over the next few days, how can we take part and help?
You know, we've had a variety of ways that people have been able to engage, including using a sweepstakes, which was a novel idea to try to get this other one of the other seats that Jared was willing to give to us. But you can go to stjude.org/inspiration4 and you can make a donation on our website. You can watch the YouTube live stream tonight and you can make a donation there. So there's a variety of ways to engage. We have some really cool items, Soledad, that we're going to be auctioning off, including a Kings of Leon and, you know, NFT, a non-fungible token. And we've got some a Martin ukulele that's going to be played up in space, and cool space pens and jackets and all sorts of things that are going to be up in space. So really cool stuff.
Great way to get people involved and raise money, of course. Talk to me for a moment about Haley Arsenault, pediatric cancer survivor on this flight. She is so remarkable.
Haley, I've owned Haley Soledad now for almost two decades. You know, she was a patient here when my father was the CEO of ALSAC, and my father goes all the way back to the beginning of St. Jude Children's Research Hospital. So I got to know Haley as a very, very young woman, and I've watched her grow up. I've watched her battle childhood cancer, and you know, she's one of the most inspiring individuals that I've had the privilege of interacting with. She's got a light about her. And you know, she's got this deep love of science and space, and you put all that together, and also with the fact that she's a cancer survivor, she's got a prosthetic device, and she's done all these amazing things, and now she's going into space. She's proving to everybody that's battling cancer that cancer cannot define you.
A big thanks to you, Rick, for joining us. And of course, we hope that you will more than meet your fundraising goal. Everybody else, stay with us. We are just minutes away from the live launch of Inspiration4.
Space is a place that has always beckoned us. We look out and see it and can't help but dream about it. This journey represents the next epic leap forward. Four civilians orbiting the Earth on their own.
You're gonna go to space.
Oh my God. Oh my God.
There's a lot of risk. What happens if something goes wrong?
Our mission to space had to serve a bigger purpose, which is why it's a $200 million fundraising campaign for the St. Jude Children's Research Hospital.
I'll be the first person with a prosthetic body part to go to space.
There may only be four people aboard Inspiration4, but in many ways, they represent the other 7.5 billion of us. Because if they can go, we all can go.
Welcome back, everybody. Take a look at that. You are looking at the live countdown to the Inspiration4 space flight. I'm Soledad O'Brien, and we are getting ready to watch them launch. I'm so interested in heading right to Florida because I really want to get a sense of what's going through everybody's mind right now. So let's send this right back to Florida. Katie's down there and Ron as well. Talk to me a little bit in this final 20 minutes before liftoff. What's going through your mind? What are they thinking about? What's happening?
Well, Jeff is going to know them better because he spent months, right, you know, just going everywhere with them. But from what I know of this crew, they are unbelievably excited. I mean, I don't think they're worried. I don't think they're thinking about should I have done. I mean, none of those things. They are ready to go and just wishing the clock would go maybe a little faster, but enjoying the time in their space. Well, what about for you, Ron?
I think one of the interesting things, this is kind of a unique situation in that they're fueling right now. They're just finishing up the refueling.
And that's different than the shuttle.
And it's different than the shuttle. And so the crew is hearing all that. They're hearing the valves open. They're hearing the pressurization. The abort system has been armed. Their visors are closed. They know they're getting ready to go somewhere.
And that's so, a big deal when they arm the abort system.
When they arm the abort system, if there is a time for fear, and I'm not saying this crew is feeling afraid, but they are humans, if there's a time for fear, it's that realization that if anything went wrong with that rocket, they would hit that abort switch and that Crew Dragon spacecraft would rocket away from the booster itself with a force of up to 20 Gs. Now that is bone-breaking force. So they know that possibility exists, but they also signed on for that. They trained for it. They trained for the G-forces. And they are aware that they are in a rocket that has an extraordinary success record. There have been 21, 22 uncrewed flights to the International Space Station by a Dragon spacecraft, and there have been 3 crewed flights so far, and they are basically 25 for 25. So at this point, we're shooting tonight for 26 for 26.
Exactly.
Well, and I think just the sounds of all that going on, I mean, and plus just that realization that you're
excitement.
The only ones there.
You're the only ones there within miles, and your dream is about to come true. It's going to come true in 17 minutes and 17 seconds.
Wow. Well, Ron, when you put it that way.
I know, right?
You made us all very, very anxious. Leland, can I bring you into this conversation? Talk to me a little bit about, I mean, they're talking about the countdown from the perspective of our civilian astronauts, but how about family members? I mean, you know, obviously your family must have been anxious, nervous, excited for you as well. What are they thinking? What are they going through?
You know, my mom, dad, my extended family, my sister, you know, we had broken bread the night before in the beach house. And we talked about, you know, the possibilities of what can happen, but we also talked about all the beautiful things that can happen with the inspiration of helping inspire that next generation and the work we're doing on the space station to advance our civilization. So my parents are both praying people, and they prayed for us. They said, you're taken care of. And we had everyone back in Lynchburg, Virginia, doing the same thing. So we bonded. And my second flight was even more powerful because they kind of knew what was going to happen. And so they were like, okay, you've got this. You've been there. You've done this. And we're going to get you back up home and safely.
Wow.
Hey, Ron, I know that the Inspiration4 crew was able to share some of their training with their family members. As an astronaut, does that help? I mean, I guess demystify it at least for your family members who to a large degree kind of just don't exactly know what's going on.
Yeah, I think it does. Having watched loved ones launch into space, I can tell you it's harder to watch someone that you love go into space than it is to launch yourself. And having the families be involved with as much as I can, I think, really helps because it is tough on the families as well.
I think the best take out of all of the loved ones, however, have to be Jared's children, who are 7 and 5, I believe. And when Jared is asked what his kids think about his going to space, he says, for them, it's all Baby Yoda at this point. That's all they think about space.
Well, I love that. I mean, his girls are growing up thinking that it's normal.
It's normal.
That is like the whole point.
That is huge.
Is to make that happen.
So then as we get to our countdown here, right, we're really at 15 minutes. Give me a sense of what's happening in that capsule right now.
Well, basically, a lot of the things that are happening are handing off, right? The spacecraft itself is starting to take over from the ground controllers, and a lot of the connections are being disconnected. You're going to see the hardback rollback. You know, basically, the last final preparations for launch are occurring, where they're basically detaching the rocket from the Earth so that it can ignite and go.
Because you saw the crew walkway, you know, pull away, and then soon, during this time, they're going on to internal power, configuring displays. I'm hoping that we hear a little back and forth between mission control. We'll see. Sometimes they do that, sometimes they don't. But I thought it was really cool, like the strong back that is holding, that's the support there. The arms come back, that thing goes back about 2 degrees, and is now it's... You know, they're separate.
Got to get out of the way.
Yeah, it's a great decoupling. This spacecraft right now is a machine of the Earth.
Right.
And it is slowly, with each of these steps, with each crew arm moving back and the hard back moving back, it's becoming a machine of outer space instead.
That's very poetic.
It is very poetic. How much space is there? Oh, sorry, Katie. Let me just ask a quick question. Give me a sense of how much room there is, right? You've got four people. I know they're not, like, pulling out beds. Like, no, I'm not joking.
Yeah, seriously.
They're sleeping in their chairs.
And we're in a social distancing time, so I need to know. I want to make sure they're COVID safe up there, okay?
But, you know, describe for me how much space they have in that capsule as they're getting ready to lift off.
Well, hopefully in about half an hour, they'll have a lot more, because in three dimensions, you know, you really do have more space. But they are sitting, you know, literally shoulder to shoulder, elbow to elbow.
A lot closer than we are right now.
It's exactly. Yeah. And Ron and I have each had that experience in the Soyuz. We actually went to the space station in different ships. I was already there, and Ron came up, and then I left. But, you know, that is really close quarters, and yet once you...
It's like three people in the trunk of a car.
Yes.
It's
really
true.
Is. Yeah.
It's true. And so once you get up there, you know, for three of us, you know, orbiting the planet for a couple days before we docked to the space station. I mean, it was a marvelous place to be.
Wow.
The Gemini.
Yeah, amazing, amazing.
Soledad.
Yeah, you know, when you say three people in the trunk of a car, it's like, oh, I think I get it now.
I get it now, yeah.
Wow, no space at all. You know what, I want to check out what is in the Dragon capsule. Let's take a look.
Here's how you fly a SpaceX Crew Dragon spacecraft. Climb aboard, strap yourself in, close the hatch, fly to space. The Dragon takes care of everything, so relax and enjoy the ride. The new ship has nothing to do with NASA's old Mercury, Gemini, and Apollo capsules that were very much designed with an airplane cockpit in mind. Their sheet metal instrument panels were studded with hundreds of switches, dials, lights, and analog gauges. The astronauts would use a control stick to fly the vehicle. The Dragon's designers swept all of that away, replacing everything with three large touch screens. Each screen is capable of calling up as many as 10 sets of displays. Ideally, the spacecraft helps the astronauts so much that they have virtually nothing to do with the ship operating entirely autonomously. Only if the Dragon runs into a failure would the astronauts take over. System failures can occur in space, and learning to fly the Dragon by hand can take some doing. Stripping out the control stick and replacing it with buttons on a touchscreen makes for a more elegant spacecraft, but it also eliminates the physical connection a pilot has to the vehicle. Inspiration 4 will be in orbit for 3 days, flying independently, without the security of arriving at the International Space Station. The right engineering and the right crew can make things a lot safer.
It's pretty exceptional to learn all of that. Now, from what I understand, this crew has a busy few days ahead of them. And Jeff, I have a question for you. What's on the calendar for the Inspiration 4 team once they're in orbit?
On the calendar for them, experiments they're going to do while they're up there?
Yeah. What's on the calendar for them while they're there? Is this just a relaxed mission, or is there actual
job? They'll be doing a lot of experiments there.
Okay.
No, they're medical experiments. They'll be taking blood draws in order to study the microbiome. They'll be taking ultrasounds in order to study, as we talked about, the fluid shifts inside the body in space. Because remember, in zero G, fluid moves up, which creates pressure on the brain. It creates pressure on the optic nerve. They'll also be conducting neurocognitive studies. They will be swabbing the walls of the spacecraft itself to look for the microbial environment of the spacecraft. Because remember, once you put people into an otherwise pristine environment like a spacecraft, you have microbes, you have bacteria, you have viruses. So all of this has to be studied.
Well, and actually, when you read that list to me, it doesn't sound all that much fun, right?
Yes.
But I did actually love doing some of that stuff up on the space station. But what's, I think, amazing is that, like, an experiment that they do, seeing, can we actually, you know, take a little, you know, prick of blood of your finger and then analyze that up in space.
That's right.
So that it really is opening the door for so much more research that we can do while we're up on the space station. Yeah. You know, right now we're still fairly limited, although getting better at having to bring samples home. So a lot of this is like pioneering a really small ultrasound device. I mean, when I was up there, it was a big complicated machine. We can understand a lot about our bodies and how they change and what that means actually for us down here, especially, I hate to say it, as we age, but we're not aging today.
And I'll
throw it back to whoever wants it back in New York.
As they say, Katie, beats the alternative, absolutely. So before we watch this incredible event, and we're very close, we're looking at just over 8 minutes before they launch, let's hear a little bit more about the vision behind it. Here's SpaceX founder Elon Musk.
If you look at SpaceX, their vision right from the start is make humankind a multiplanetary species, because we got a lot of eggs in one basket here. It didn't go really well for the dinosaurs.
The reason I started SpaceX was to help make life multiplanetary, to get humanity to Mars.
The future is vastly more exciting and interesting if we're a spacefaring civilization and a multiplanet species than if we're not. And I can't think of anything more exciting than going out there and being among the stars.
It's important for the future of humanity to be a multi-planet species so that we better understand the nature of the universe and also protects against some calamity on Earth.
There has been a good amount of backlash to this so-called billionaires in space.
Sure.
The criticism is, we have enough problems on Earth, why are we spending time, energy, and money getting off of Earth? What's your response to that?
Yeah, I mean, I don't think we should spend I think we should spend the vast majority of our resources solving problems on Earth. Like 99% plus of our, you know, economy should be dedicated to solving problems on Earth. But I think maybe something like 1% or less than 1% could be applied to extending life beyond Earth. Think about a future where we are a space-faring civilization and a multi-planet species. I think that's an exciting, inspiring future. If life is just about problems, I mean, what's the point of living?
Okay, everyone, so we are at about 6 minutes away until this launch, and it's starting to feel like New Year's Eve to me, except for, if I can be honest, normally during this point at New Year's Eve, I had a couple of drinks in me, so,
let's
still
launch, and then we can all drink. I'm totally fine with, like, getting through the launch once we know they're safely in orbit. I am 100% with you on that. We're literally just a few minutes away from the I-4 launch. Let's go back down to Florida. Jeff, in a lot of ways, this is much more ambitious than the other private missions we've been talking about that have happened this summer. Give me a sense of how the Dragon goes into orbit.
Well, we're working with a 230-foot machine, which has basically three stages. At the top of it is the Dragon spacecraft itself. At the bottom is the first stage of the rocket that provides the initial muscle. And in the middle, we've got a second stage. That first stage will ignite and burn for about 2.5 minutes and carry the crew up to an altitude of about 50 miles, which will take them about halfway to space. At that point, the first stage will be jettisoned. It will, if Elon Musk's systems work the way they always work, it will then descend back to Earth and land safely on a recovery barge. The second stage will ignite and carry the spacecraft the rest of the way to space. They will reach orbit at about 8 minutes, 8.5 minutes after ignition, which is an extraordinary amount of time, an extraordinarily brief amount of time to be on the ground and in orbit. And after 8.5 minutes, they will be in orbit. They will be traveling 17,500 miles an hour. As Katie said, as Ron said, that's about 5 miles per second. So that's a lot of acceleration in a short time.
And that's a lot of G-forces, too. They're going to feel that G-force the whole way up.
Yeah. And we've been talking to colleagues who've flown on the SpaceX, and it is apparently just a terrific ride to space, in that, I mean, Ron and I have both flown on the shuttle and also on the Russian Soyuz, when the shuttle's, you know, pretty big, you know, right, with all the tanks and the shuttle, like, looking like an airplane. But then the Soyuz is smaller, and I don't know about you, Ron, but I just remember when I launched, it just is in this visceral way, you just know it is so hard for people to leave the planet.
Yeah.
But this rocket, apparently, even compared to the Soyuz, leaps off the pad.
I am so excited to watch it.
Riding on the Soyuz, it was almost like we were wearing the rocket on our back.
Hmm. Wow. Yeah, that's amazing. So before we watch this historic mission take flight, and the countdown clock says 4 minutes, 16 seconds, quick refresher on what you need to know about Inspiration 4. Take a quick look. Actually, because we're so close to the launch, let's go right back. And Ron, I had kind of cut you off because I wanted to get a look at sort of the things we need to know. Tick off for me what our audience needs to know with our remaining 3 minutes, 47 seconds before liftoff.
Yeah, we're coming down to the final moments. The crew knows this. They are anticipating now that they're going. They've gotten the go. The vehicle has taken over, and it's just a matter of watching those seconds tick off. And they start to accelerate towards zero at this point. And I think they're, at least I remember wondering the first time I flew, what I was getting myself into. And they're about to find out. And you know, when the shuttle launches, you see this billowing white smoke, and it kind of lumbers off the pad. But what it feels like inside is, it feels like you just got released by a slingshot, a giant slingshot. You leap off the pad, and this rocket's going to do the same thing.
And you are not stopping until you get to space.
You're not stopping. There's no doubt you're going somewhere, and you're going somewhere fast.
And in this rocket, from what I understand, like, so first stage, that's off the pad, on the first stage for the first 2.5 minutes. And during that time, they're going to slow down through max Q, that point of maximum dynamic pressure, in that the crews that have gone say they can actually feel that deceleration and then accelerating again. So they're feeling all these things. We go, oh, SEP, you know, this thing's going to separate. They are feeling every one of those things.
And what's going to happen at separation? So 2.5 minutes, the 9 Merlin engines are going to do their job, and they're going to cut off. And when those engines cut off, they're going to go from being pushed in their seat, feeling like an elephant is sitting on their chest, to thrust, all three or four of them are going to thrust out of their seats towards the display panels, and then when that second stage engine kicks in, they're going to slam back into their seats with a thud. I remember in the Soyuz it was like that, and we all started laughing because we couldn't believe how amazing that was.
That's Sir Isaac Newton at work.
Yeah.
Yes, absolutely. Well, you know what? With 1 minute and 56 seconds left to liftoff, I think it's a really good time for us to turn this over to SpaceX so we can watch a flawless launch. Take a look.
And there's the call that stage 2 locks load is
complete.
Dragon
is an auto idle.
Falcon is now fully loaded with all of its propellants.
Gas closeout will begin shortly. Expect loud venting.
Announcement to let the crew know that as we vent off various lines on the launch pad, we'll hear some loud noises. Let the crew know that's planned. We're also right now draining liquid oxygen out of the transporter erector, draining the lines, getting ready for launch. Waiting for the startup call at T-minus 1 minute.
You can hear the cheers. We're inside 1 minute.
Go for launch.
Inspiration 4 is go for launch. Punch it, SpaceX.
Commander, call it down.
30 seconds.
Punch it, SpaceX.
T-minus 15 seconds. 4.
Copy, 1 Alpha.
Vehicle's pitching downrange.
Oh my goodness.
Okay, prompt 1 to
go Inspiration 4.
T plus 30 seconds. Callouts indicate nominal. Historic mission flying the Inspiration 4 crew. Onboard Dragon and Falcon 9, late view of the crew in the capsule. We're into the throttle down, into the throttle bucket.
Stage 1, throttle down.
Throttling down in preparation for the period of maximum dynamic pressure. Minute in the flight.
Falcon 9 is supersonic.
Stage 1, throttle up.
We're through the period of maximum dynamic pressure.
Copy,
we're throttled back up, and 1 Bravo, the call out from space. That's one of the abort sequences. That is a nominal call. Everything continues to be good. Looks like a smooth ride for the crew. Through 3G's acceleration, everything continues to look nominal. Merlin engines are throttling down for G limiting. 4G's, we're holding it there for the crew. Major event coming up will be main engine cutoff, followed by stage separation. Looking at the second stage engine nozzle and then ignition of the second stage.
Wow, it's amazing as we get to watch every stage. And he says at the end, it's looking good. It's looking good. Next stage, it's looking good. I mean, they've done it.
There it goes.
Look at that. There it goes. Inspiration 4 has blasted off from Kennedy Space Center, getting set to leave the Earth's atmosphere. Rocket literally into history. We're watching truly a landmark moment for humanity. I think it's fair to say that. For the first time ever, all civilian crew entering the orbit of our planet. And if in the future space travel is accessible to the many, and I think it's going to be. I hope that it's not just the wealthy. I hope that it's for the many. This mission will truly stand as an inflection point, an accomplishment that opened the door to a new kind of space explorer. You know, in this crew, you don't see career adventurers or larger-than-life, you know, NASA icons. You see regular folks, regular everyday people who said yes to an opportunity to challenge themselves and stretch the bounds of their reality and gain this incredible perspective that is rarely ever afforded to anyone.
Yes.
They're avatars, I guess, of our own imaginations, and they're expanding our world in real time as regular people who said yes to an incredible opportunity.
This moment is touching my heart in so many different ways, because to be able to see people who I feel like could be my aunt, my teacher, my friend, my doctor, my nurse, that are here. Let's go ahead and listen to Mission Control a little bit right now, because they're saying something that's pretty important.
Normally, with them,
And you can also track the velocity on the second stage on the bottom right-hand side of your screen. And we also have awesome views of the crew inside of their capsule as well.
I'm pretty sure during first stage ascent, I saw Dr. Sian Proctor. I'm pretty sure I saw Dr. Sian Proctor give us two thumbs up. Yep. I'm sure she enjoyed this ride that she's been waiting for her entire life.
Yes. One notable thing, too, is we're getting some twilight views. The sun just set in Florida, but we're high enough up where the light around the horizon is also reflecting off of very high altitude objects, such as the first and second stages.
Dragon, SpaceX, trajectory nominal.
Love to hear that call out, trajectory nominal from the guidance engineer. Also notice we're really up there now.
All right, let's go back down to Florida where our team is. So I need your reactions. How are you feeling? What do you think? Let's start with you, Ron.
Well, that was just amazing. You know, I've seen a lot of launches and they're no two are alike. It's just, but they're all amazing. They instill awe and wonder. You could feel it. You don't just hear it, you feel it. And it was really exciting.
And even just watching them just now, I mean, we still have a ways to go, right? They're still in the second stage, and so I don't know. I hold my breath probably all the way until exactly. Those main engines cut off. But to me, I think the fact that we got to know these people, they were generous in that way, and we got to know their families. That when I saw that going up, and I thought of every single one of them, and yes. There's just something. I mean, I'm sort of like, you know, kind of. Always patting something or grabbing something. It's really in a very emotional event to watch a launch, at least for me.
I bet it is.
And every launch. Every launch carries precious human cargo, and this group is just somehow different, somehow more relatable, somehow more reachable than a lot of the other missions that have flown. And that's what makes this mission, I think, a little more touching and a little more poetic.
And Jeff?
And we've got about 2 minutes before that main engine, that second stage engine will cut off. Mm-hmm. So they're all being pushed into their seats. Like I said before, they feel like an elephant is sitting on their chest. Mm. And they're going to go from that feeling to being weightless instantly when that engine cuts off. And then at that moment, they're going to realize they made it. They made it to space. Their childhood dream of flying in space has come true, and it's going to be exuberant.
So I have to hold my breath for two more minutes. Is basically what Ron is telling
yes,
us.
Exactly.
The main engine. Leland, when you see all this, I mean, what are you thinking? What's going through your mind?
I really believe that it's not about the mission they're doing. It's not about the journey they're going on. It's about who you do it with. Mm-hmm. It's who you travel with. And as we've looked, as Ron and Katie and Jeff have said. We've seen this group of people come together to form a family, to form a team, to go off planet together, to do something that's never been done before. And we're in such a new era of spaceflight that this is going to open the doors for so many new families of civilians to come together as one to go off planet.
I think you're really, really right about that. Let's dip back in and listen to Mission Control again.
Of two burns on the first stage. Again, this first stage has already separated from the second stage. So
stage
the first
one,
stage
burn, shut down.
Is making its way back to Earth, trying to land. And the second stage, everything is going well. It is headed into orbit with the crew on board.
Actually, there on your screen, you can see a sunrise horizon there with planet Earth just behind the glowing MVAC engine.
Stage two is in terminal guidance.
Call out stage two and terminal guidance. We're at the altitude. We're working the angular momentum we need to get into the right orbit. And if you're wondering, crew's pulling about 3.5 Gs right now, less than they took on the first stage flight.
So in about 15 seconds, we are expecting.
Copy, Shannon.
We are expecting. The MVAC to throttle down and cut off in an event called second engine cutoff, and then we'll wait for the confirmation of good orbit. At the same time, the first stage will be beginning its landing burn. And here we have the MVAC. We just saw that it shut off its engine.
Stage one, landing burn, go off.
Dragon SpaceX, normal orbit insertion.
All right, good news there. Nominal orbit insertion. That's amazing news for Inspiration 4 crew.
An unexplored frontier. A few have come before and many are about to follow. The door's opening now, and it's pretty incredible.
Stage one landing is confirmed.
And Dragon SpaceX launch escape system is disarmed.
And you can hear the excitement behind me. We just heard from Jared thanking everyone for making this mission possible. The Dragon capsule and crew are in a nominal orbit. In a few minutes here, we'll begin opening that. In a few minutes here, we'll separate from the second stage. And then shortly after that, we'll begin opening that nose cone. At the same time, we landed our first stage on the drone ship, which is super exciting.
As if the second stage action wasn't exciting enough.
Right.
So Leland, walk us through what we're seeing at this moment, because it's so interesting to hear the people in Mission Control, right, talking. I mean, they're so happy and, yes. and cheering. What exactly are they excited about that's going so well?
Well, the first stage has landed on the drone ship, so they can reuse that for another mission that's coming up. But when you look at the four astronauts now, because they are actually in orbit. They're floating in orbit. And it's pretty soon after the second stage comes off of the crew capsule, we're going to have them getting out of their seats and, you know, doing their floating. The things that, you know, Karamo, you're going to do one day when you float and move around in space. But I think it's this moment where they're going to, they're celebrating this auspicious thing that Jared put together.
Yeah.
To do something that no one's ever done before.
They talk about the different phases, right? They were like phase one, sort of like check. Now we move on to phase two. And as phase two was completed, you saw that landing on the barge, which,
right.
of course, was pretty remarkable. They were right. very excited about that. What are the next phases that they need to hit where people feel like, yes, we are moving along the right path to a very successful launch and next 3 days?
Right. Well, I mean, the main thing is getting that second stage back down. And then getting the checks from the ground to make sure that everything's stable, you know, they're in the right orbit and all those things. And then to start getting out of your seat and turning your spaceship, your rocket ship, into your home, you know, activating the toilet, you know, pulling out some of the stowage and things so that you can start doing the experiments.
Yeah.
Opening the nose cone so you can look down at the planet and do Earth observation, getting that perspective shift that, you know, everyone changes their whole cognitive way of thinking when you see back on the planet and see those blues of the Caribbean Ocean.
Their lives have changed, right? These are now celebrities.
Well, this is the moment that I hope everyone at home is realizing. You're witnessing history. Like, these are the moments that in 10, 20, 30 years from now, we'll be talking about this moment as we see it unfold and how it really truly affects our lives. When you, me, our kids, our grandkids, our great-grandkids are in space, this is the moment that started it all. And I think this is mind-blowing to me.
Yeah, it's amazing.
Like, what were you doing when?
What were you doing when civilians went to space?
We were here.
Yeah.
So when they talk, you hear them talk about the Dragon deploying. What are they talking about exactly?
So that other stage has to come off, and then you have the Dragon capsule and the other piece where they're going to actually have to live in. That's where they're going to be living in. So the kind of the trunk of the vehicle. And the deployment of the nose cone is going to be a piece coming out so they can actually look out the window.
And because they're going fast enough, they can stay in orbit for these 3 days. It's not going to be the short window.
Right. Not like the Virgin Galactic ship or the Jeff Bezos Blue Origin ship. They're going 17,500 miles per hour. Think about like a rock on a string. When you're spinning a rock on a string, you have enough speed so that tension stays in there so that it doesn't go that way or this way. It goes in this orbit. And that's exactly that magic number of 17,500 miles per hour will have you go around.
Mm. Let's check back with our folks in Florida, Ron and Katie and Jeff. I guess I'd love, maybe Katie, you can start for me. Your first reaction now that you've seen it happen successfully. I noticed you said, like, let's wait till second stage gets off successfully.
Well, and you were asking about, you know, what means they're what does it mean that they're off to a good start? And it is, you know, having the engines fire and completely, and then getting rid of that second stage. And now they are literally, you know, on their orbital mission. And so I kind of had to wait and see all that stuff happen. But when Leland said it's about who you're with, I really thought, that was what's important as well. And, you know, Ron and I Ron and I flew in space together. And, you know, you're always, actually all of us, I think, who've been in space together, I mean, not together, but as astronauts, are a family. And I'm just really excited that we have, you know, four more people who are members of that family. And I think it's not about so much exactly who you do it with, but who you do it for. And what they're doing it for and what we've always been all about as well, it's the same, is that you bring a lot of people with you.
Mm. Yeah, we talked about all the research that they're going to do, all the scientific experiments, but they're also going to do a lot of outreach. I know Cyan's going to teach a class. I know that there's a lot of outreach with St. Jude's.
Chris is going to do music.
Music. And so, yeah,
Chris,
there's going to be art, music.
There's
a lot of exciting things that are going to happen over the next 3 days.
Yeah, I actually think those are the things, frankly, that the people who are watching remember. I mean, I know you guys are scientists, so you remember the experiments. But I think as people just watching, you know, watching someone play the guitar in space or teaching a class from outer space, like, that's just remarkable and amazing. And I love that they're doing those very things. I think they're going to be talking to patients from St. Jude's, you know, from the capsule, which will be really, really remarkable.
Well, I think that's one of the most special things. Again, I know we've talked about this entire time, but the fact that this is not just one of those billionaire missions where it's just like, oh, okay, let me show off. There's actually going to be people who are going to be receiving help. The $200 million that they're going to be giving to St. Jude's Hospital is pretty extraordinary right now, because that's going to be helping so many children and their families beyond this. But to go back quickly to the music, I just want to let y'all know, when I go into space, I am going to be jamming Beyonce. Be very, very clear about
everyone,
that.
Everyone, make a note. Make a note of that. Who
Beyonce
did you play?
Will be in space
what
with
me. What music did you play in space?
I took up Quincy Jones's CD, Fly Me to the Moon. And then he called me.
In space?
He called me in space. And he said, Leland, math and music.
Quincy Jones
called me in space and said, math and music are the only two true absolutes. If you know math, you know music. So, Quincy, from Q.
Wow.
So, hold on. Did y'all get that? Quincy Jones is making calls in space, and Leland was the one that picked up the phone. Tell me, not to go back, is it possible if I go to space that Beyonce can then finally call me in space?
She will call you if you go.
Jared Isaacman, please hit me up right now. I am ready to go to space. I am ready to suit up, all in an effort to get on the phone with Beyonce and to, like, advance our civilization.
I would like to point out that the beginning of this conversation, he was like, never going
there.
Well,
that's because I didn't know there was an option to get a Beyonce on the phone. That's,
amazing. Yeah. All right, let's check back in. I really want to hear what Mission Control, they're doing a great job, by the way, I think, of really explaining. They know that people who are not scientists are really listening in to hear what's happening and how it's going. Let's listen.
This is the INSPIRATION4 mission, the first all-civilian crew into space. The team had a nominal ascent out of Pad 39A in Kennedy Space Center and are currently in orbit around the Earth.
Yeah, what an incredible place to be in right now when we can say we have now put four civilians into space, into orbit. It's been an incredible journey for us to get here. You know, we didn't do this alone. There's a lot of history working with our partners, NASA, to get us to this point. A lot of efforts with reusability and reflying vehicles, which we've seen on this mission particularly. We've reflown the booster three times. Dragon, we flew for a second time here. First flew on Crew One last year. And now Jared, Cyan, Chris, and Haley are out in space.
Yeah, it's pretty incredible. Just the fact that these are normal, regular people, non-professional astronauts, and they're now in space. And
acquisition signal, O'Kanger.
And it's just wonderful to know that the access to space has opened up. I believe in the note that Jared...
It's been so much fun to listen to Mission Control because they are so excited. Yeah. I mean, in the beginning, of course, they were very reserved.
Yes.
And now that it's gone off without a hitch, they're very, very excited. When you think about how challenging the last 18 months or so have been, I think, for everybody, it's kind of nice to have something to highlight. Again, it's not billionaires in space. Love billionaires, not billionaires in space. It is regular people who are really, I think, changing how we think about accessibility to space. And so, you know, I guess I just really feel like this is a tremendous opportunity.
It's the hope that we need right now with all the things that are happening in the world. It's a little bit of, it's a glimmer of hope and inspiration when people that you would never have expected to fly in space I mean, Haley, you know, her story, a prosthetic cancer patient at St. Jude's, now in space for the first time to talk to kids at St. Jude's about what it's like to be off the planet.
How about Cyan, a black woman who tried twice to become an astronaut?
I was on her selection. I interviewed her to become an astronaut.
And dinged both times. She didn't make it. And at 51, someone calls her up and says,
want to go to space?
Guess what? Your dream is happening. Like, that is just amazing.
Yeah.
It is. And I think it's just been such a rough, you know, 18 months. It's such a nice thing to be able to talk
and
about.
And there's so much lessons that, again, we've talked about earlier that we can take from this inspirational four of what we can do here. Yes, I love the fact that we're in space now. I love the fact that this is showing us what's possible for the future. But this is also showing everyone at home, like, if there's challenges in your life, things that you're going through, this is a moment for you to reflect and say, right, I can make change. Right. I can make things happen in my own life right here on Earth. Of course, we talked about it earlier. Billionaires, we love them. We love the fact that you started something, but at the end of the day, this is actually something where we as regular people can say we're proud of these four individuals that are in space right now, and we're going to use them as a guiding force and a guiding light for us to even be better here on Earth.
It is very, very cool.
Yeah.
It's just cool. A big thank you, of course, to everybody who joined us this evening. We hope that you've enjoyed this as much as we did, and certainly as much as the people in Mission Control
exactly,
who are going crazy cheering with that momentous launch, the Inspiration4 mission. It has now officially begun, and we're going to get a chance to see much more of their journey in that fifth and final episode of Countdown Inspiration 4 Mission to Space. It drops on September 30th on Netflix. In the meantime, make sure you catch the first four episodes. They're streaming right now. Really, really good.
Yeah. And everybody look out for me, because I'm going to be in space soon, because I found out I can get a call from Beyonce. So I'm going to space. Y'all heard it here first.
Inspiration 4, Godspeed.
Have a great
night, everybody.
The reason I started SpaceX was to get humanity to Mars. We want to try to make the dream of space accessible to anyone, and ultimately making science fiction not fiction forever.
What they're about to do will change the game entirely. Four civilians are going to space. They will orbit the Earth for 3 days.
On their own.
You know, my dream of always wanting to go to space. I wanted to let you know that I got selected.
They start telling me about this all-civilian mission to space.
How many astronauts are going? And that's when she said, none.
Haley was diagnosed with bone cancer.
I haven't died, and I'm not going to die.
Having cancer made me who I am.
My dream is to be a nurse.
I'm getting to show them what their life can look like after cancer.
If I can do it, you can definitely do it.
I went upstairs after the phone call, though, and told my wife, I think I'm going to ride a rocket. And she just, what?
I don't think I'll think about the worldly impact this mission is going to have until Chris is back on the ground.
I'm like, why would they choose me?
Look at that.
But my dad had instilled this idea in me that I could do anything.
I'm commander of Inspiration 4. No matter what, I'm a father first, and that comes with a great deal of responsibility.
What is the speed?
You know, 25 times the speed of sound, or 17,500 miles an hour.
Oh, wow.
Yeah.
It's getting real.
Our mission to space had to serve a bigger purpose, which is why it's a $200 million fundraising campaign for the St. Jude Children's Research Hospital.
There have been three black female American astronauts who have made it to space. I will be number four.
I started thinking about what could happen and the risks that are involved.
These people are you and me, and they will kick the doors open to space for the rest of us.
This is where we're gonna live for 3 days.
Home sweet home.